Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, a kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all of my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I serve. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Oh, Savior. He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Good morning, everyone. We've got a full house here today. Got lots of visitors and guests, and a special treat today with the bell choir from Park Street. We're just so happy y'all are here today to share your talent. Let us open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day, and we thank you for the talent that has come to share with us today. Lord, we ask you to be with us throughout this service and throughout this day and throughout this week. Be with us. Let us shine your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise as we recite together the Apostles' Creed found on page 881. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing as we worship God through song with Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, but God, who
Our testament reading this morning comes from Hebrews chapter 7, verses 23 through 28. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office, but he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. The word of God for the people of God.
Peace the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Well, good morning and welcome to Bethesda United Methodist Church. It is so good to be here this morning. I was away last week. It was Laity Sunday, and I'd just like to express a thank you to those who filled in my absence. Jim, I think you brought the word, and I certainly appreciate that, and all who participated. It was so good for Susie and I to take a little time off and be away. But, you know, it's good to go, but it's always so good to come back. And it's good to come back here this morning and see so many faces that I haven't seen in quite a while. So many of my friends from Park Street, we welcome you. I know you've been welcomed before, but it's just a joy to see all of you here this morning. And I'm really looking forward to hearing y'all play the bells this morning, the handbells. So it's a real treat. I asked them, I said, please put it deeper in the service so that I will be able to get here to hear it. I didn't want y'all to do it too early so I could hear your performance. But we're looking forward to that. But anyway, do we have any praises this morning? Has anyone seen God work in their life or in the life of someone else in the past week or so or 2 weeks? Who has unspoken needs this morning just by a show of hands? I think I see just about everybody here has a special need. So let us go now to the Lord in prayer. You know, this is sometimes time-consuming to take all these prayer requests, but you know, I believe it's a very important part of our worship because God cares about your prayers, about your concerns, about our needs. So let us take just a couple of moments of silence. And I encourage you to pray for yourself during this time. Let it be a time of self-examination or intercession. So let us go now to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, our Creator and our Redeemer, our Giver of life, we call upon you this morning. We give you thanks and we give you praise for all the mighty works that you have done, for all the things that you continue to do in and through our lives. Oh Lord, we thank you this morning for this time that we can gather together as other believers come together to worship you. Lord, we thank you for this time, for this place where we can gather, a place where we can come and share our joys and share our sorrows with one another, a place where we can call upon you for our needs and our concerns, a place where we can express our desires, a place where we can feel comfortable and secure, where we can have and exercise our right of free speech and freedom of religion. We thank you for this place, O Lord, that where we can come and set aside this time, where we can lift up our voices in praise to you, where we can open up your word and read your holy word, where we can come to you in reverence and in prayer. We thank you for being a God who loves us and cares for us, who not only answers our prayer, but hears our prayer. Oh Lord, we thank you for all these things. We thank you for Jesus Christ, for the sacrifice that he has made for us, for his love that he has for each and every one, for his resurrection, and that we, through his resurrection, have hope and assurance of our own resurrection. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that comes to us, that shares and touches our lives, who leads us and directs us, who whispers in our ear, who corrects us when we get out of line. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that watches over us, has your hand upon us. We thank you, O Lord, for all these things. But Lord, as your people, as human beings, we come before you this morning with many needs, many concerns, with much sickness and much illness, much grief and pain in our lives. And Lord, we want to lift up those who were mentioned by name. We pray for John Allen, for Mike Smith, for Nancy and Dick Howie, for Dale Sharon, Ava Philbeck, and for Dale, their friend, Susan Van family, for Kevin Withers and Steve Hubbard, for the Child Advocacy Group, for Lisa Donaldson, Johanna, for Don and for Tim Leinberger. And Lord, for all those who raise their hands that have special needs, concerns upon their lives. Lord, you know them better than they know themselves. You know their needs and their concerns. And we pray, O Lord, that you will work in their lives. Lord, that as you work in the lives of your people, it will strengthen our faith and make us stronger. Build up our faith, O Lord, as we call upon you. Lord, we also want to call upon you to be with those first responders, our police, our firemen, our medics, those who come to us in times of need. And Lord, we pray for our men and women in the military, both here at home and abroad, and for their families, for our president, all of his aides, politicians. Lord, we pray for our country. We pray, O Lord, that we might turn our hearts to you once again, that we would become a nation who trust in you, our God and our Creator. O Lord, that we might have revival within the hearts of each and every one. We pray for this world in which we live in. There is so much chaos, so much hatred, so much pain and war. We pray for peace, a peace that only you can bring. Lord, we also pray for those who have rejected your church, those who have put aside your calling, those who are lost and do not know your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray for each and every one. Lord, we also pray that you would give us doors of opportunity that we might encounter those people and share our stories with them, that we can share how our lives have been changed, how you have changed our lives and all things have become new, that we can share this wonderful story of the good news of Jesus Christ. We ask all these things in the name of the one who died on the cross for our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now I'd like to invite everyone that's able to please stand and let us recite the Lord's Prayer. As we stand and we lift up our voices to God, let us open our hearts, open our minds, open our hands, that we might receive a special blessing as we pray this prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I think everyone is just about back to their seats again. And I'd just like to say one more time how much we appreciate Park Street Handbell Ringers to be here with us this morning. It's a special privilege for me. Since I came from that church, it's certainly a blessing. And to see y'all that are here. So please, y'all enjoy.
I'm Jess Labar. I have the honor and privilege of being the director of this wonderful Halo Choir. And we have two of your members, Rita and Tracy, who have blessed us with filling two positions that we had available. And they jumped right in and said, okay, tell us what to do. We're willing to play. And so they jumped right in with us and they joined us. So since they've been playing with us for a while now, we wanted to come and share what they've been working on with you guys so we can share that. So thank you for sharing them with us each Sunday afternoon. And I'd like to read to you this song that we're playing first. It's called Prayer for Peace. And the composer, Michael Hellman, actually wrote some notes about this piece. The events of September 11, 2001 dramatically affected us all. As someone who visits New York City on a regular basis, I truly felt a personal loss. Many times I started my day with a train or ferry ride across the Hudson River to the World Trade Center. Watching the events unfold on television, I felt a strong need to see firsthand what was left of New York's great landmark. My feelings were only heightened as I played for the funeral of the young man killed in the Pentagon on that fateful day. So at the end of September, I made a pilgrimage to Ground Zero. I was profoundly moved by what I saw that day. No television camera or journalist's words truly captured the destruction and devastation of Lower Manhattan. What could I do for all those families who lost loved ones, not only in New York, but at the Pentagon, and in the air crash in Pennsylvania? I set pen to paper and poured out my feelings and my prayers in music. I hope that others will hear this prayer for world peace and remember not only those who lost their lives on September 11th, but also the heroes and heroines who toiled so desperately trying to save lives. My hope is that this composition may be a prayer for an end to terrorism and for peace throughout the world.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Park Street Joyful Ringers. I overlooked this prayer shawl that I should have prayed for when I done the pastoral prayer. I'm going to ask Maggie. She has a special need for this that she's going to take to someone. So I'm going to ask her if she will come and pray with me as we pray over this prayer shawl. It's a special ministry that we have here at this church. Several of the ladies take the time to knit these things, and we give them to people in need. So we're just going to ask a blessing upon it now. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you once again, thanking you for all of your blessings. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful ministry that you have given to us, this ministry of the prayer shawls. And Lord, as we pray over this prayer shawl, we ask that whoever receives it, Lord, that they will get a special blessing, that they will know that they are cared for, that they are loved from this church, and that through your Son, Jesus Christ, and through the Holy Spirit, Lord, that they will be touched and will be healed and be blessed. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. How many of you brought your Bibles with you this morning? Let me see who brought their Bibles. Hold them high. Let me see who got their Bibles with them. Amen. Amen. Thank you. I always encourage you to bring your Bibles to church. If you have them, open to the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 10. Our passage is taken from chapter 10, beginning with verse 46 through 52. 46 through 52. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. And so they reached Jericho. Later, as Jesus and his disciples left town, a great crowd was following. A blind beggar named Bartimaeus was sitting beside the road as Jesus was going by. When Bartimaeus heard that Jesus from Nazareth was nearby, he began to shout out, "Jesus! Son of David, have mercy on me." "Be quiet," some of the people told him. But he only shouted louder, "Son of David, have mercy on me." When Jesus heard him, he stopped and said, "Tell him to come here." So they called the blind man. "Cheer up," they said. "Come on, he's calling you." Bartimaeus threw aside his coat, jumped up, and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked. "Teacher," the blind man said, "I want to see." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has healed you." And instantly the blind man could see. Then he followed Jesus down the road. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. May God bless the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of his holy word. You know, as we read this miracle of Jesus healing a blind man, we think, oh, well, just another one of Jesus' miracles where he healed a blind man. But this is more than just an average miracle. It's an act of faith by this blind man. You see, as we listen to this story about Jesus, we don't have any idea what Jesus and his disciples were doing in Jericho. We know that what was taking place in Jericho was outside the walls of Jericho. And there, that has an interesting ring to it, because years and centuries before, there had been an act by Joshua and some of the priests there at Jericho. So this took place outside of Jericho as Jesus and his disciples and the large crowd began to go down this road to Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem and Jericho are about 15 miles apart, about the same distance as from here to Charlotte. So they had started on that road with a great crowd following behind them. You see, they were going to Jerusalem because it was soon going to be Passover. And Jewish law required that any adult male over the age of 12, if he lived within 15 to 20 miles of Jerusalem, it was imperative that they come and be present in Jerusalem during the Passover. So that's why so many people were headed to Jerusalem. That's why there was a great crowd following Jesus. In those days, it was more of a safety factor to travel in large groups so that you wouldn't be robbed or harmed by the bandits that were out on the roadways. So that's why you had this large crowd. It's also an interesting fact that there were over 20,000 priests and Levites that lived in Jericho. These priests and Levites served in the temple. Now, I found that astounding that there were so many, 20,000. Now, they took turns, they rotated, and I don't know how many would be there each week. But, you know, I found that's not really all that unusual. How many of us live in Gaston County but work in Mecklenburg County? So we travel from one area to another to do our profession. And that's what was taking place even in Jesus' day with all these priests. So these priests were also part of that group who were making their way to Jericho, to Jerusalem from Jericho. So it was when the Bible says it's a large crowd, it was a large crowd. And so here they are on the road, and you got this one man who's yelling and screaming, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Now, he must have known that Jesus was coming that way. We don't know how long he had been there. We don't know how long he had been blind. But we know that at one point in time in his life, he could see, because in other translations, it says that he wanted to see again. So he had been able to see at one point in time in his life. But he's wanting to see once again. So he's calling out to Jesus, Son of David. He calls him Son of David because he recognizes that Jesus is the Messiah, that he is going to be the Savior of the people. And so that's why he's addressing him that way. It's also important that he is named Bartimaeus, that they mention his name. A lot of times in the parables and in the stories of Jesus, Jesus healed the blind man. He healed the leper. But we don't get the name of the person. Now, Bartimaeus, the word B-A-R, bar, means son of. So he was the son of Timaeus. But it's important that he's making it more personal by calling him by name. Have you ever noticed our politicians? So many times our politicians, they want to tell stories. And when they tell stories, they name someone. I've listened to Obama many times when he's doing a State of the Union address, and he's telling about some individual who was in Fargo, North Dakota, and he tells about this person and he names them by name. And in State of the Union address, many a times those people are even present there and he points them out. They're sitting with his wife. Many times you'll have war heroes that are there and he mentions them specifically by name. So here Jesus is calling this man Bartimaeus. He called him by name. It's an important thing. It becomes a very personal thing when we hear our names called. So anyway, Jesus was talking and telling this man to come to him, and the crowds had been telling this man to be quiet. Be quiet. Don't be shouting out to him. Leave Jesus alone. But he ignored them. He ignored the crowd, and he continued to shout even louder. How many times in our lives do we listen to the crowd? How many times are we influenced by what other people say and we're not listening to what God is telling us or what we know in our hearts that we should do? We're listening to other people. We're listening to other sounds. I was watching the bell ringers. And as I was watching the bell ringers, they weren't paying attention to us. They weren't even paying attention to each other. They were paying attention and they were focused on their job at hand. That's what they were focused on. And so that is the way it should be in our own lives. When God is calling us, we should be focused on the task at hand. Not worried about what everybody else is saying, about what everybody else is doing. Not worried about what everybody else is wearing or what everybody else is eating. We should be focused on what God is calling us to do. So many times the crowds get it wrong. The crowds get it wrong. I watched a TV show once. I used to watch it a lot. This Price is Right. And the contestants, when they get up there, they have to come up with a price. What do? They listen to the crowd. They're going, what, what? You know, they're not paying attention to what's at hand. I think for yourself, person, you know, lady, gentleman, Think for yourself. You're the contestant. This is your time to shine. Don't listen to everybody else. But yet, that is so human nature that we want to listen to what everybody else is saying and not be focused on the task at hand. This man, Bartimaeus, he was focused. He knew what he wanted. He wanted something from the Son of God. Every one of us here today have a need. Every one of us has something in our lives. Some of us have more than one need. I heard many of you when I asked for prayer requests, you had special needs. And we pray for those needs. But there's others that raised their hands that was unspoken request. We all have things in our life that we need. Just like Bartimaeus had a special need in his life. He wanted to see. He was focused on it. He didn't let everybody else get in his way. He was determined that he was going to see Jesus, that he wanted Jesus to hear him. Are we that determined in our lives? Most of the time we have something in our lives and well, Lord, if it's your will, you know, maybe it'll come to pass. We're just so passive. We're not aggressive enough in our prayers and in our prayer life that we seek out God with passion and with desire like Bartimaeus had. He was serious. He wanted to see. Can you imagine being blind and if you had the opportunity to have your sight restored? I can't imagine how motivated this man was. If only we could get that motivated when we go to God in prayer. When we petition God for the things that we need, we just don't get excited. We just kind of nonchalantly pray to God Almighty in such a passive voice. And our lives reflect that we're not being in such a strong, motivated mode when we pray to God. And here was Bartimaeus shouting out, the people telling him to be quiet, be quiet. But he wouldn't listen. He continued, and then Jesus heard him. Then Jesus heard him and said, bring him up here. And then what happened? The people changed. They said, hey, cheer up, cheer up. He's calling you. Come on, let's go. Bam, just like that, the crowd changed. Is that not the way the world is? They go whichever way the wind is blowing. It doesn't matter. They go with the flow. And that's what was happening here. And Bartimaeus was able to go to Jesus. And then Jesus said to him, what do you want from me? What can I do for you? Can you imagine standing before Jesus and Him asking you, what can I do for you? Wallace, what if Jesus was standing in front of you and He says, Wallace, what can I do for you this morning? Can you imagine how that would affect you? It's better than winning the lottery. What can I do for you? And Jesus is asking us that today. He continues to ask us that today. What can I do for you? Jesus wants to do for us, His people. But are we willing to do what Bartimaeus was doing? Man, he throwed off that coat and he took off. Now, there's something to be said about that coat. A beggar who had a coat, it was very important to him. That coat was his security. It was his shelter. It was his bank. It was everything he had was that coat. And he was ready to throw it off and leave it behind and go to Jesus. How many times we hold on to things in the past? How many times we hold on to old habits, the old way of doing things, and not willing to let it go and run to Jesus and let Him offer to us what He can do for us. Too many times in our lives, we want to hold on to these things. Not Bartimaeus. And he got his sight restored. He didn't have to do anything. He just simply asked for it. And Jesus said, your faith has made you whole. Your faith has healed you. Go your way. Did he go his way? No. Bartimaeus decided that he was going to follow Jesus. And he became part of that crowd following Jesus. Who knows what happened to that coat? He didn't care anymore. He had his sight. He had a new life. He had been transformed. And God is willing to do that for us here and now this morning. Jesus is still calling us, what can I do for you? What can I do for you, Bethesda Church? What can I do for you? There is so much out here in this world that Christ can do for us. We all are blinded by different things in our lives. We're blinded by things just like Bartimaeus was blind and could not see. It might not be a physical blindness. It could be an emotional blindness. It could be a financial blindness. It could be a relationship blindness. There's so many things that we are blinded to in our lives that we just don't see. I've talked to people who have had eye surgery, who had cataracts removed or LASIK surgery, and they say, you know, I just didn't know what I was not being able to see until I had this surgery. Folks, in our lives as Christians today, there's things in our lives that cause us to be blinded, that we're not able to see the things that God wants us to do. And He is willing to heal us of our blindness. Help us to see our potential so that we can follow Him. Just as Bartimaeus was following Christ on that day, we too. This is more than a miracle. It's an act of faith. We have that same invitation this morning. Jesus is saying, what can I do for you? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you for this story about Bartimaeus. We thank you for his faithfulness, for his perseverance. Lord, help us to learn from this that we too might be more eager, more enthusiastic in our prayer life. That we would come to you. We would expect great things. That we would get excited about what you can do for us. Lord, we know that you are a mighty God. And we know that you're eager to do things for us. Lord, help us to prepare our hearts and our lives that we might be the person that you have called us to be. Not looking at the crowd, not looking at the world, but focused on what you can do for us. We thank you, O Lord, for this wonderful story, that we might learn from it and that we might be a disciple who will continue to follow you and do great things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was lost, but now I'm found. So far away, but I'm home now. I once was lost, but now now my life song sings. I once was blind, but now I see. I once was blind, but now I see. I don't know how, but when he touched me, I once was blind. But now I see, and now my life song sings. Life to you I give.
God bless you.
Folks, I feel like I've been in church today. Praise be to God. Let us go forth from this place and let us take church to the world around us in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.